Next on Unsolved Mysteries. Margot Freshwater was a teenage femme fatale when she was convicted of murder. Then she escaped and is still on the run. A millionaire's burnt-out car is found in a remote field with his dead body inside. Is it suicide or murder? A Ouija board identifies the ghost that's terrorizing a family. And now they can't get it to leave. When a fishing boat sinks, four men are cast adrift. Only one is rescued. Were the other three picked up and held against their will? I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Tennessee, a young blonde named Margot Freshwater finds herself in an unlikely place, prison. She has just been convicted of first-degree murder, but Margot will not be in prison for long. The guard is unarmed. Freshwater and her accomplice make a run for the fence.
The guard had to make a decision whether to stay with the main group or chase after them. All the guard could do was try to summon some help and have somebody go after them.
But the help arrives too late. Freshwater has vanished. Margot Freshwater has been a wanted fugitive for more than 30 years. Police believe she's established a new identity and a new life. Those around her probably don't realize that Freshwater is a convicted killer. Margot Freshwater was just 18 years old when she walked into the office of 41-year-old Glenn Nash. He was a hard-drinking lawyer whose grip on reality was beginning to slip. Nash was being investigated by the Memphis Bar Association for misconduct. He was sure that their agents were conspiring against him.
Glenn Nash was an intelligent person, but somewhere along the line, his drinking and mental situation apparently deteriorated, and he just took a left-hand turn.
Mr. Nash?
Glenn Nash.
Margot Freshwater.
Margot needed a favor from Nash, help her boyfriend get out of jail.
Well, I'm here because of my boyfriend. He's in the Memphis jail right now for armed robbery.
Margot was a young, attractive blonde, very good figure. And Margot had the distinct ability to turn a man's head when she would walk by.
And I just drove down from Ohio to help him out.
I believe Margot was seduced by Nash. She didn't have any life experience, especially with any kind of situation like this.
Margot had no money to pay Nash. She couldn't even afford a place to stay while she was in town. Nash agreed to take the case for free, even though he was broke himself. He also put Margot up at a local boarding house where they began an intense affair. At the same time, Nash was convinced that agents from the Memphis bar were closing in. One evening, he told Margot's landlady they were going bowling. Instead, they went on a three-state crime spree.
All the money in the register right now. Right now, let's go, come on.
I believe that Glenn Nash had lost touch with reality.
Get the money, come on!
I really think he was fantasizing that he'd go in and rob somebody and there wouldn't be any consequence to it.
Come on, come around, let's go. Keep an eye.
Nash ordered Margot to stay up front while he took the cashier to the back room. When a customer came into the store, Margot waited on him. Meanwhile, Nash remained out of sight, accusing the cashier of being an agent of the Memphis bar. Hillman Robbins, the cashier, was tied up with rope and shot 5 times in the head. A .22 caliber and .38 caliber were both used in the murder.
I seriously doubt Margot knew that any of this was coming until it got started.
Witnesses saw two people matching Margot and Nash's description flee the liquor store and hop into a white Ford Fairlane. 12 days later, eyewitnesses described an almost identical scene at a Florida convenience store. A couple exited the building and sped off. Inside the store was the body of Esther Boyer. She had been shot in the neck. Police did not connect the two murders until they found Nash's abandoned car. In the trunk, they found a rope and bullet shells that matched those used in the Hillman Robbins murder. The car was traced to Glenn Nash and an APB was issued. But the couple's rampage was not over. A cab driver, C.C. Surrette, was shot to death shortly after picking up Glenn and Margot. The police staked out the nearby bus stations. Their efforts paid off.
Freshwater, you're under arrest.
What for?
Boys.
Glenn Nash and Margot Freshwater were charged with the murder of C.C. Surrette. Nash was declared insane, ruled incompetent to stand trial, and was incarcerated at a mental hospital. Margot stood trial for the murder. She testified that she was held prisoner by Nash and was forced to participate in the crimes under the threat of death.
Everyone's gone. Take this place.
I don't know if I
you
can do this
will
again.
Will do this.
Margot Freshwater, in my opinion, was in a psychological condition where she wouldn't attempt to escape from Nash, fearing being killed.
I don't think that Freshwater was a victim in any way. She had opportunity after opportunity to leave, not commit these crimes, but I think she enjoyed it.
Twice, the jury failed to reach a verdict. 3 years later, Margot was tried for the murder of their first victim, Hillman Robbins. She was found guilty and sentenced to 99 years in state prison. But she would not remain there for long. Margot and another inmate hopped a barbed wire fence, hitched a ride, and disappeared. Her accomplice was eventually arrested in Chicago. But Margot Freshwater seemed to have vanished off the face of the earth.
I would say that she has changed her life around. She is probably living as a mother, or maybe even a grandmother at this time. Margot committed a crime, and she needs to spend her time in prison and serve that sentence.
Update. Margot Freshwater has been arrested. It began with a tip that she was using the name Tanya. Police found a match between Freshwater's birth date and the birthday of Tanya McCarter in Columbus, Ohio. Freshwater, aka McCarter, was taken into custody and her true identity was verified. At the time of her arrest, Freshwater, a mother of three, was with her family. They were unaware of her criminal past.
She said nothing and was surprisingly emotionless. She then wanted to say goodbye to her son and husband, and we allowed her to do that.
Freshwater was returned to the same Tennessee prison she escaped from 32 years earlier. She served her time and has been released. Coming up, the fiery death of a Texas millionaire. Was it suicide, murder, or a clever hoax? In a remote rice field 20 miles outside of Houston, Texas, flames destroy an expensive Jaguar. Inside, sheriff's deputies find a charred body. The car is registered to millionaire oil well promoter Edward Gerald Baker. Forensic tests indicate that the body is most likely his.
Ed Baker had built a multi-million dollar oil business practically overnight. And then his empire came crashing down. Did Ed Baker take his own life, or was he murdered?
If you met him, you'd never expect Ed Baker to be at the center of a deadly mystery. His company, Vanguard Groups International, was one of the fastest growing businesses in the United States.
He always knew he had the potential to have a very successful business. And I think he tried his best to manage that business honestly and with a great deal of integrity.
Where was it? 34.
When Baker started his oil well business, his timing was perfect.
$3,500 is your upfront investment here.
Houston was booming. After his first oil wells came in, he had no trouble selling his clever tax shelters to wealthy investors.
Okay, but here's the kicker. Here's the kicker, Frank.
He was acknowledged as a pretty brilliant strategist when it came to developing these little tax shelter programs at that time.
4 years after Baker started Vanguard, its sales reached $19 million. Baker's sudden wealth brought on many changes in his life. He divorced Mary, his wife of 10 years, and got involved with high-stakes gambling. He had two facelifts and bought a flashy new Jaguar. Baker also remarried twice. Then his financial empire began to disintegrate.
I promise you, there is nothing to worry about. The wells will come in. Has Vanguard
but ever let there was something to worry about. Baker was taking his clients' money to support his lifestyle.
He was looking at some serious charges from a lot of his investors. He was looking at, turns out, serious tax problems. It may have been very true that he was about to go to jail.
Vanguard was on the edge of bankruptcy. Baker apparently arranged to borrow money from a highly suspect source.
Ed, we need to talk. Not on the phone, okay?
I got the impression from Ed he's talking big money, such as millions. He was preparing to have some financial dealings with these individuals that he had heard that they had some sort of mafia connections.
What took you so long?
I took the back roads.
Ed Baker seemed unable to reverse his downward spiral. One night, he showed up at his ex-wife Mary's house. He seemed very upset.
Sit down, I'll get you a cup of coffee.
I was really kind of shocked because he was real pale, and he was afraid he was being followed. And this was very unusual, and it didn't fit what I normally knew.
Now tell me what this is all about.
I really didn't want to get you involved with this, Mary.
He told me that he had received death threat letters at work, and that day he had received two telephone calls at his unlisted home number telling him this is your day to die.
Hello?
Baker, it's time to die.
Who is this?
Why don't you call the police?
I can't do that, Mary. The police won't do anything until something happens.
And he got in his car and drove away. And that was the last time I saw him.
Ed's new wife, Sandy, says her husband sent her to Austin as a precaution. She says she spoke to her husband around 1 a.m. He was hiding out in their bedroom because he had received another death threat. Two days later, investigators found the charred remains in Baker's burned-out Jaguar. It
appeared that the subject in the car had been shot. There was a burnt .32 caliber revolver in the right front floorboard, which would have been at the passenger's feet. When we opened and examined the .32 pistol, the cartridge underneath the firing pin had an indentation in it, like it'd been farred.
Somebody obviously was trying to burn the car. It appeared at the time that it was a rather crude effort. We found 3 gallon cans of gasoline inside that vehicle and around that vehicle, more than enough to sufficiently burn it up.
That same day, a letter from Baker arrived at his attorney's office.
It said, "Dear Ward, if you are reading this letter, it means that I am dead. I've had some threats on my life. You've been a good friend to me. Please take care of Sandy and the kids and do what you can for them. And enclosed is another letter that I would like you to take out to Sandy and give to her for me."
The fate of Ed Baker became the subject of intense speculation. His wife, Sandy, is convinced that he was the victim of a mafia hit. An eyewitness told police that he saw a blue Chevy pickup truck speeding away from the field where Baker's car was found. The truck and whoever was in it have never been located.
I think somebody was paid to kill Ed Baker. And that's exactly what they did. Ed Baker did not commit suicide.
But law enforcement investigators believe that's exactly what he did. In the days before his death, Baker called his life insurance agents to ask if his policies would pay in the event of a suicide. One, valued at $500,000, would not.
"I believe it's a possibility that Mr. Baker shot himself, committed suicide, and that he had an accomplice that set the car on fire to make it look like a homicide so that all of the insurance policies would pay off."
The letter I got said, "If you're reading this, I am dead." How did he know he was going to die that night, unless he planned on going out and killing himself? I think Ed decided that he was about to probably go to jail and decided to get Sandy out of town so that she wouldn't be implicated. Said goodbye to everybody that he loved, went out to this field that he knew about, set his car on fire, and shot himself.
From what I know about fire, and I spent over 20 years in the business, I don't believe an individual can pour gasoline on themselves, ignite it, and be able to stay calm and still enough to reach down and put a gun to their head and pull the trigger.
Some believe Ed Baker staged his own suicide.
"I feel the possibility that Ed could arrange something like this with a different body in that vehicle. Ed was a very intelligent man, a man that took in, as he told me himself, $66 million the last year that he was in business. And a man capable of doing that is capable of faking his own death."
Bob Gale and others believe the body in the car might not have been Baker's. They think Baker may have faked the suicide and fled to an unknown location, perhaps the Caribbean, to live in luxury on funds embezzled from his investors. While this theory may seem unlikely, the fate of Ed Baker remains an unsolved mystery. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, a family is tormented by a persistent ghost with a bad attitude. If you happen to be in Lake Wales, Florida, there's a house you may want to avoid. It's an ordinary-looking house, but appearances can deceive. 19-year-old Alan Mann lived in the house with his parents. Alan worked nights, and during the day he was often home alone, or so he thought.
"I had the afternoon off. I'd come home, and I guess it was about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I'd finally gotten some sleep. Figure turned away from the door like it was leaving. And by the time I got up and walked 3 paces to the door, I don't know what happened, it just turned the corner and disappeared."
When Alan Mann told his mother he thought he'd seen a ghost, his mother told him she thought he was crazy. And that was that. Until Alan got married and his 16-year-old bride, Linda, moved into the house. Mm-hmm.
Shortly after the wedding, Alan's mother, Sandra, was watching TV with her new daughter-in-law.
I don't know why I watch these reruns.
I had my little dog, Prince, beside me, and he was laying on a pillow. And I looked down at the end of the couch, and I saw this white, smoky thing. And the first thing I thought was fire, and by that time the dog had gotten up on his feet, and it just disappeared. And Linda snapped around and you know, like, what's going on?
Is there a spirit present?
Even though Linda hadn't seen the ghost, she was convinced the house was haunted. She and Alan found a friend with a Ouija board.
Yes.
I believed in it. I've believed in that kind of stuff for a while, but I never come across it until then.
What's your name?
According to Linda and Alan, the board spelled out the name Kramer. Alan's father wasn't convinced.
I thought I was living with a bunch of flakes. I didn't want to have anything to do with it. If it was a paranormal experience or something like that, I didn't want to have to worry about it. I just didn't want to admit it.
I haven't seen it in a long time.
Linda and Alan knew there was a ghost, but they weren't prepared for what happened next.
You okay? What?
All of a sudden, she just snapped. And she got this weird look.
What has gotten into you?
She was laughing. She had some weird laugh I had never heard. Didn't even sound like her. She has this squeaky little giggle. And this was almost an evil laugh.
We remarked a few times, you know, well, what's going on? And it just kept getting louder and louder and louder.
There's something wrong with there.
Dan, I don't like the sound of this.
Linda! Let go of my wrist, Linda!
She was holding me down, and normally she can't hold one hand down with both her arms.
Linda, what has gotten into you?
I tried to get away, and it made her get more violent. And I slammed her against the wall three times, and she released me. And she put her head on my shoulder again and started talking and picked up the conversation exactly where she left off before she snapped.
I don't have any memory of what happened. That's not me. I don't have an evil laugh. I don't do the things that he says I do. That's just not my type. I'm not that type of person.
Whatever had happened to Linda was enough to alarm the family.
And I really got concerned, and so at that point I said, look, I'm gonna go get some help. Somebody, somewhere can tell me what the heck is going on.
A spiritualist told the mans to pour salt all around the house. They kept bags of salt under their beds. And even tried a homegrown exorcism. Nothing helped.
We were gonna do anything anybody told us to get rid of this stuff. Every time we tried something, couple days, it would settle down, and then it would be stronger.
Then, the house began to smell, usually like a burnt-out motor. Everyone in the family suffered from bad headaches. Some of the rooms had a deathly chill. And then...
what we heard was like a whole mass of voices, dull, muttering, and one woman voice over the top of them. But yet you could not distinguish anything they were saying.
What time is
it? 9:30.
David and Sandra tried to act like nothing unusual was happening. But the ghost wouldn't let them.
Okay.
I stopped right in the middle of the hall. I caught the smell again.
Sandra, tell Isabella to leave me alone. I do not want to have anything to do with her. Nothing.
And I didn't have any explanation for her. It's like you get an idea, that little voice that you listen to. David, how do you know her name is Isabella? And I didn't have any explanation for her. It said, you know, this is Isabella.
Linda and Alan decided it was time to move out.
Are you almost done over there?
We had a couple boxes left, and she was defaming the ghost, cussing it pretty bad. Right in the mid-sentence, the light bulb exploded. Lasted maybe half a minute or so. Then the bulb just fizzed out and died.
I upset the ghost very bad. I just wanted to hurry up and get out. No one tell her how I felt about her before I left one last time.
News of the haunting reached the Center for Paranormal Studies in Florida. Armed with a truckload of equipment, the center's three founders showed up at the house.
Living room area where Sandra had her experience.
Right, this is where I had the apparition experience.
As we drove up to the house, I felt sort of an emptiness inside. And as I went into the house, the air seemed to get thicker, and it had an odor, and it was uncomfortable.
To me, the house had a presence that was profoundly unpleasant. An extremely foul smell, kind of like rotting flesh.
Things have happened all over the house, but particularly Alan's bedroom.
It definitely had an oppressive ambiance to it, almost a depressive type of feeling. After being in the house for several hours, we all began to experience headaches.
Bedroom B.
In Linda and Alan's old bedroom, the electromagnetic equipment went crazy.
Getting some magnetic flux here. It's off the scale. You don't normally see this fluctuation. It was very, very high. So I thought it would be a good idea to start taking a series of photographs at that point.
Andrew Nichols took two Polaroid shots, one during and one after the peak electromagnetic activity. The second photograph was normal, but the first wasn't.
I thought it was just a washed out photo, but over the subsequent minutes, this image started forming.
There was a vague humanoid shape in the forefront of the picture. It may be a reflection of some unusual environmental effect. It may be a strange artifact of the human psyche, or it may be a contact with a dimension of existence that's beyond our imagination.
When I looked at it, I knew that that was what I had seen at the end of the couch, that was Isabella. I was real excited about it, to see that somebody else could see her too.
2 months later, after a visit from a local minister, the haunting appeared to stop. But David and Sandra had enough. They too decided to move out.
I felt that as a result of what we had done, we might have slowed it down, but I doubt very seriously if we had stopped it.
The Manns could never find records proving Isabella Kramer ever lived in their house, but that didn't matter. They had all the proof they need. Next, three fishermen are lost at sea, but some believe they survived and are being held against their will. Richland Hill, Georgia, just south of Savannah. Four commercial fishermen prepare for a 7-day trip in the Atlantic. The captain is 23-year-old Billy Joe Neesmith. The crew includes his brother Nathan, his nephew Keith Wilkes, and a friend, Franklin Brantley.
We ready, let's go fishing.
Franklin, you in?
In the late afternoon, they set off in the KC Nicole, a snapper boat owned by a man named Doug Tyson. The boat had just recently spent 5 weeks in dry dock for maintenance.
I guess it was somewhere around 3:30, 4 in the morning, that next morning. It was still dark. I had got up and was operating the boat, and the boat just seemed to be sluggish, you know, like it wanted to bust through the waves, kind of like a submarine or something. It didn't want to ride over the waves. So I told my brother, he was laying in the bunk. I woke him up. I said, something's wrong with the boat.
What do you mean it won't stay on course?
We got to noticing around, the boat was riding pretty deep in the water.
Jesus, Nathan, we're 2 foot down. Oh, man, Nathan, we got 2 foot of water down there.
And we started working on our pumps, trying to get our pumps to work, pump the boat out.
How about now? Nothing. We gotta get them boys up, Nathan. We gotta start bucking this water out here right now.
The other crew members slept down in the bow, And when we turned on the light, we noticed there was water about a foot deep down in the bunks where they were at.
We're sinking, y'all. Come on, get out. Come
on. And we got in a line and started passing the bucket, you know, trying to bail the boat out. In the meantime, we took the life raft out. It was a two-man life raft. We'd been hollering Mayday on the radio. We had Billy Joe on it, working it.
Taking the water, going down. Somebody come back in it, please.
Never did get anywhere with that. And the engine finally stalled.
Casey, Nicole, we're going. No more power.
All power on the Casey Nicole was lost. The radio, useless. The four men abandoned ship.
Life raft was kind of rotten. It had a hole in the side of it up on the top. We don't really know what happened there, but we do know that it had a hole in it about the size of a quarter.
By sunrise, the life raft was sinking fast. Then, salvation came floating by, the hatch cover from the Casey Nicole.
I got it. You got it? Oh, it's here.
The foreman tied the raft to the hatch cover and climbed aboard. Then, Nathan saw the hull of the Casey Nicole in the distance.
It looked like it was maybe 3 or 4 miles from us. I said, I don't know what kind of chance we got, but at least maybe one of us can make it to the boat and get some kind of help. Well, that's what I struck out to do. And they started hollering, no, no, you come back, we separate up. We're gonna be split up, and ain't no telling what to go wrong. I just kept swimming and kept swimming. I swam from probably about 9 o'clock that morning, and just before dark that afternoon, I got to where I thought was what the boat was. I drank so much salt water trying to swim in it, and I was just real weak.
Nathan lost sight of his companions as darkness fell. He spent a long night clinging to the hull of the Casey Nicole. The next morning, a freighter passed within 3 miles of Nathan.
Looked like it made about 4 stops, maybe 5 stops. And each time it would stop or circle, and it was in the direction that my other mates had went. So I figured that maybe it had stopped to pick them up.
The freighter continued its odd movement for nearly 3 hours, then disappeared. For 2.5 days, Nathan drifted and prayed that the Casey Nicole would stay afloat. Suddenly, a large wood and styrofoam bait box broke loose from the boat's deck and popped to the surface.
I swam over to it. I got to the front of it, and bless God, the whole front was out. I mean, it was just like a boat. It was really hot. I mean, I was getting real sunburnt. My skin was turning real, real red, and I was very close to dead. I mean, I remember saying, God, please let me go home to my wife and kids.
Nathan Neesmith was finally rescued 20 miles off the coast of Georgia. He had been adrift without food or water for 4 days. Despite a large-scale search, the other fishermen were never found by the Coast Guard. Even so, Nathan and his family never gave up hope. And then one day, Nathan's sister, Onita, received a very curious phone call. It was 6 months after the Casey Nicole had sunk. Onita's mother-in-law answered the phone.
Hello. No.
The caller, a man, spoke only in Spanish.
All this person would keep saying is repeating our phone number and saying our name. And that's all. You know, we just kept saying, hello, hello. And it was just cut off, static cut off.
That same day, Doug Tyson, owner of the Casey Nicole, also received the call.
Hello?
Again, the caller spoke Spanish. The name Tyson and their phone number were the only English words he used.
That was strange.
6 weeks later after that, we were down visiting with the Neesmith family, and they started telling us about their call. And after they got through, I said, how long ago was this? And they said, about 6 weeks. I looked at my wife, she looked at me, and she said, about the same time, eh? I said, yeah.
In the next year, 5 more calls came in, 3 to Onita and 2 to the Tysons. Finally, the caller spoke a single sentence in English.
Hello.
I'm bringing him home.
Excuse me?
Very simple words. Not I'm bringing it home, I'm bringing him home. Just said I'm bringing him home.
Hello? Hello?
After a moment, the connection was lost, and there have been no calls since then. The Neesmiths and Tysons are convinced that the 3 missing men were taken aboard the passing freighter and brought to a foreign country against their will.
I think they're somewhere being held. I really do. And I think that whoever called us is putting themselves on the line.
People are lost at sea. They're never found, I realize that. But there's no explanation for where the debris went. And then the fact that Nathan's seen the ship stop the first day with the phone calls, you add all those together, and I think it adds up to a tremendous amount of hope.
I know they had a lot better chance of surviving than I did. I don't think that I would have ever made it, not knowing that they couldn't make it.
Officially, Billy Joe Neesmith, Keith Wilkes, and Franklin Brantley are presumed dead. Unofficially, there seems to be reason to hope that they may still be alive. If you have any information, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, a man loses custody of his children and becomes a killer. In a previous broadcast, we examined the case of Maria Armstrong. When she was in her early 20s, Maria was diagnosed as suffering from paranoid schizophrenia, a physical disease of the brain. A few years after her diagnosis, Maria moved to Mesa, Arizona, to live with her childhood sweetheart, 29-year-old Ron Argenti. He was aware of Maria's condition, but felt that he could somehow help her overcome her illness.
We were concerned because we did hear that she was in a mental institution, and we knew she was on drugs back east. But, you know, they were holding hands, kissing. They were like a couple.
For the first few weeks, Maria seemed to be doing well under Ron's loving care. Though most schizophrenics are not violent, Maria soon began to attack Ron.
Maria, calm down.
Stop leaving me alone! They told me about you! And I would tell him, Ronnie, you have to do something. It's obvious you can't help her. She needs more than you to help her. She needs psychiatric care.
5 months after Maria moved to Mesa, Ron's body was found in his living room. He had been bludgeoned to death with a sledgehammer while he slept on the couch. Maria was seen hitchhiking 260 miles north of Mesa, Arizona. This was the last reported sighting until our broadcast. Update. Maria Armstrong has been found. Shortly after the story aired, the FBI received a call from one of our viewers.
We received a telephone call that Marie Armstrong had been living in the Memphis, Tennessee area, and that she was going to be at the airport. The FBI subsequently went to the airport and were able to identify her, and they did place her under arrest.
Armstrong had changed her appearance by dyeing her hair blonde. After several hearings to determine her mental competence, Maria Armstrong pleaded guilty to second-degree murder. She was sentenced to 15 years in prison. In Greenville, Illinois, City Attorney Thomas Meyer was found shot to death in the alley behind his office. One of the first to respond to the scene was the chief of police. Thomas had been his best friend.
It was one glance and I knew that it was him, and there was no life left.
Thomas had multiple gunshot wounds. There were no witnesses to the shooting, but fingers pointed at one suspect from the start. Kelly McGinnis had recently clashed with Thomas in this courtroom. Thomas had represented McGinnis's ex-wife in a legal action regarding the custody of their two young children.
Kelly McGinnis felt that the children would be better off with him, but the result was that Mrs. McGinnis was awarded custody and Mr. McGinnis was awarded some visitation, a fair amount of visitation.
McGinnis refused to accept the decision as final. Just hours before the murder, McGinnis was back in the courthouse, still angry about being denied custody. He was next seen near the alley where Thomas Meyer was killed. Police tried to find McGinnis for questioning, but he had vanished. A day went by, a week. Then 10 days after the murder, McGinnis mailed 5 letters from Central Illinois. He wrote, "Clearly, the only winner in a divorce case are the lawyers. Their gains being made at the expense of the children." The killing shattered Greenville's sense of security, and some were afraid that McGinnis wasn't through. Update. After Thomas Meyer was killed, 3 months went by. Then, Kelly McGinnis walked into the office of his former attorney and opened fire with a shotgun. Incredibly, no one was injured. McGinnis was taken into custody as he left the building. Kelly McGinnis was sentenced to 60 years in prison for the murder of Thomas Meyer, plus an additional 10 years for the shotgun attack on his former attorney.